apprentice rises from indenture freed. Strong his arm and keen his scent is, he's a pirate now indeed.
Here's to luck to Frederic's ventures, Frederic's out of his adventures.
22 now he's rising, and alone he's fit to fly, which we bent on signalizing with unusual little eye.
Here's good luck to Frederic's ventures, Frederic's out from his adventures. For a poor pirate ship, we'll a build a pirate boat, and to make us all a very let the pirate come to pass.
Frederic, from today you rank as a full-blown member of our band.
Aye!
My friends, I thank you all from my heart for your kindly wishes. Would that I could repay them as they deserve.
What do you mean?
Today I am out of my indentures, and today I leave you forever.
But this is quite unaccountable. A keener hand at scuttling a Cunarder or cutting out a piano never shipped a handspike.
Aye!
Yes, I have done my best for you. And why? It was my duty under my indentures, and I am the slave of duty. As a child, I was regularly apprenticed to your band. It was through an error. No matter, the mistake was ours, not yours, and I was in honor bound by it.
An error? What error?
I may not tell you. It would reflect upon my well-loved Ruth.
Nay, dear master, my mind has long been gnawed by the cankering tooth of mystery. Better have it out at once. When Frederic was a little lad, he proved so brave and daring. His father thought he'd prentice him to some courier seafaring. I was, alas, his nursery maid, and so it fell to my lot to take and bind the promising boy apprentice to a pilot. A life not bad for a hardy lad, though surely not a high lot. Though I'm a nurse, you might do worse than make your boy a pilot. I was a stupid nursery maid, on breakers always steering, and I did not catch the word aright through being hard of hearing, mistaking my instructions, which within my brain did gyrate. I took and bound this promising boy apprentice to a pirate. A sad mistake it was to make and doom him to a pilot. I bound him to a pirate, you, instead of to a pilot. I soon found out beyond all doubt the scope of this disaster, but I hadn't the face to return to my place and break it to my master. A nursery maid is not afraid of what you people call work, so I made up my mind to go as a kind of piratical maid of all work. And that is how you find me now, a member of your Shylock, which you would have found had he been bound apprentice to a pilot. Oh, pardon, Frederic, pardon.
Rise, sweet one. I have long pardoned you.
The two words were so much alike.
They were. They still are, though years have rolled over their heads. But this afternoon, my obligation ceases. Individually, I love you all with affection unspeakable. But collectively, I look upon you with a disgust that amounts to absolute detestation. Oh, pity me, my beloved friends, for such is my sense of duty that once out of my indentures, I shall feel myself bound to devote myself heart and soul to your extermination.
Poor lad! Poor lad!
Well, Frederic, if you conscientiously feel that it is your duty to destroy us, we cannot blame you for acting on that conviction. Always act in accordance with the dictates of your conscience, me boy, and chance the consequences.
Besides, we can offer you but little temptation to remain with us. We don't seem to make piracy pay. I'm sure I don't know why, but we don't.
I know why, but alas, I mustn't tell you. It wouldn't be right.
Why not, my boy? It's only 11:30, and you are one of us until the clock strikes 12.
True. And until then, you're bound to protect our interests.
Hear, hear!
Well then, it is my duty as a pirate to tell you that you are too tender-hearted. For instance, you make a point of never attacking a weaker party than yourselves. And when you attack a stronger party, you invariably get thrashed.
Some truth in that.
Then again, you make a point of never molesting an orphan.
Of course. We are orphans ourselves and know what it is.
Yes, but it has got about, and what is the consequence? Everyone we capture says he's an orphan. The last three ships we took proved to be manned entirely by orphans, and so we had to let them go. Britain's mercantile navy was recruited solely from her orphan asylums, which we know is not the case.
But hang it all, you wouldn't have us absolutely merciless.
There's my difficulty. Until 12 o'clock I would. After 12 I wouldn't. Was ever a man placed in so delicate a situation?
And Ruth, your own Ruth, whom you love so well, and who has won her middle-aged way into your boyish heart, what is to become of her?
Oh, he will take you with him.
Well, Ruth, I feel some little difficulty about you. It is true that I admire you very much, but I have been constantly at sea since I was 8 years old, and yours is the only woman's face I have seen during that time. I think it is a sweet face.
It is. Oh, it is.
I think it is. That is my impression. But as I have never had an opportunity of comparing you with other women, it is just possible I may be mistaken.
True.
What a terrible thing it would be if I were to marry this innocent person and then find out that she is, on the whole, plain.
Oh, Ruth is very well indeed.
Yes. There are the remains of a fine woman about you.
Do you really think so?
I do.
Then I will not be so selfish as to take her from you. In justice to her and in consideration for you, I will leave her behind.
No, Frederick, this must not be. We are rough men who lead a rough life, but we are not so utterly heartless as to deprive thee of thy love. I think I'm right in saying that there is not one here who would rob thee of this inestimable treasure for all the world holds dear.
Not one!
No, I thought there wasn't. Keep thy love, Frederick, keep thy love.
You're very good, I'm sure.
Well, it's the top of the tide, and we must be off. Farewell, Frederick. When your process of extermination begins, let our deaths be as swift and painless as you can conveniently make them.
I will. By the love I have for you, I swear it. Would that you could render this extermination unnecessary by accompanying me back to civilization.
No, Frederick, it cannot be. I don't think much of our profession. But contrasted with respectability, it is comparatively honest. No, Frederick, I shall live and die a pirate king. Oh, better far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly than play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well-to-do, but I'll be true to the song I sing and live and die a pirate king. For I am a pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is the love of the pirate king,
the love of the pirate king. I sally forth to seek my prey, I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more sips, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king on a first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more a dirty work than ever I do. For I am a pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is for love the pirate king,
for love the pirate king.
Oh, take me with you. I cannot live if I am left behind.
Ruth, I will be quite candid with you. You are very dear to me, as you know. But I must be circumspect. You see, you are considerably older than I. A lad of 21 usually looks for a wife of 17.
A wife of 17? You will find me a wife of 1,000.
No, but I shall find you a wife of 47, and that is quite enough. Ruth, tell me candidly and without reserve, compared with other women, how are you?
I will answer you truthfully, Master. I have a slight cold. But otherwise, I'm quite well.
I'm sorry for your cold, but I was referring rather to your personal appearance. Compared with other women, are you beautiful?
I have been told so, dear Master.
Ah, but lately?
Oh, no, years and years ago.
What do you think of yourself?
It is a delicate question to answer, but I think I'm a fine woman.
That is your candid opinion?
Yes, I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you, Ruth, I believe you. For I'm sure you'd not practice on my inexperience. I wish to do the right thing. And if, I say, if you are really a fine woman, your age shall be no obstacle to our union. Hark! Surely I hear voices. Who has ventured to approach an all but inaccessible lair? Can it be Custom House? No, it does not sound like Custom House.
Confusion! It is the voices of young girls! If he should see them, I am lost!
By all that's marvelous, a bevy of beautiful maidens.
Lost! Lost! Lost!
How lovely! How surpassingly lovely is the plainest of them. What grace, what delicacy, what refinement. And Ruth. Ruth told me she was beautiful. A false one! You have deceived me.
I have deceived you.
Yes, deceived me. You told me you are fair as gold.
And Master, am I not so?
And now I see you're plain and old.
I'm sure I'm not a drop so.
Upon my innocence you play.
I'm not the one to blotso.
Your face is like your hair is grey.
It gradually got so.
Faithless woman to deceive me, I who trusted so.
Master, master, do not leave me, hear me ere you go.
Faithless woman,
master, master,
faithless woman,
master, master,
faithless woman to deceive me, I who
Very
faithless woman to deceive me, I would not. What shall I do before these gentle maidens? I dare not show in this alarming costume. No, no, I must remain in close concealment until I can appear in decent clothing.
So far behind.
Oh, he will be here presently. Remember, poor Papa is not as young as we are, and we came over a rather difficult country. But how thoroughly delightful it is to be so entirely alone. Why, in all probability, we are the first human beings who ever set foot in this enchanting spot.
Except the mermaids. It's the very place for mermaids.
Who are only human beings down to the waist.
And who can't be said strictly to set foot anywhere.
Tails they may, but feet they cannot.
But what shall we do until Papa and the servants arrive at the luncheon?
We are quite alone, and the sea is as smooth as glass. Suppose we take off our shoes and stockings and paddle.
Yes, yes, the very thing!
Stop, ladies, pray!
I had intended not to intrude myself upon your notice in this effective but alarming costume. But under these peculiar circumstances, it is my bounden duty to inform you that your proceedings will not be unwitnessed.
But who are you, sir? Speak.
I am a pirate.
A pirate?
Ladies, do not shun me. This evening I renounce my vile profession, and to that end, O pure and peerless maidens, O blushing buds of ever-blooming beauty, I swore at heart, I swore at heart, implore your kind assistance.
How pitiful his tale, how rare his beauty.
How pitiful his tale, how rare his beauty.
Does not feel the moral beauty of making love interest subordinate to sense of duty. Who would not give up willingly on matrimonial ambition to rescue such an one as I from his unfortunate position, from his position, to rescue such an one as I from his unfortunate position. And bad complexion have caused all hope to disappear of ever winning man's affection. To such an one, if such there be, I swear by heaven's arch above you, if you will cast your eyes on me, however plain you I love you, however plain you be, if you will cast your eyes on me, however plain you'll be, I love you.
Alas, there's not one maiden
not one.
No, no, not one.
Not one.
No, no.
Tomorrow we may war again. I hear the country once a ringing. People say, I never thought that we should have a war. Tomorrow we may war again. I hear the country once a ringing. People say,
must not lose our senses. Men who stick at no offences will anon be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Pray you get you hence, young ladies, while the coast is clear.
No, we must not lose our senses. Here we stick at no offences. We should not be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Nice companions for your ladies.
General.
Yes, yes, he is a major general.
Yes, yes, I am a major general.
For he is a major general.
He is the wrath of the major general.
And it is a glorious thing to be a major general.
It is the wrath of the major general, the wrath of the major general.
I am the very model of a modern major general. I've information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and Dakota fights historical, from Marathon to Waterloo, in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About polynomial theorem, I am teeming with a lot of news. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
I am very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and animalculus. In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern major general.
I know our mythic history, King Arthur's and Sir Caradox. I answer hard acrostics, have a pretty taste for paradox. I quote in elegiacs all the crimes of Helicabalus. In conics, I can flow peculiarities parabolas. I can tell undoubted Raphael some Derrida's and Sophonies. I know the croaking chorus from the frogs of Aristophanes. And I can hum a fugue of which you've heard the music's dinner for.
Dinner for.
And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore. And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore. And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
Then I can write a washing bill in Babylonic uniform and tell you every detail of Caractacus's uniform. In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern major general.
In fact, when I know what is meant by mammalian and ravelin, when I can tell at sight a mouse a rifle from a javelin, when such a phase of sorties and surprises I'm more wary at, and when I know precisely what is meant by commissariat, when I have learned what progress has been made in modern gunnery, when I know more of tactics than a novice in a nunnery, in short, and have a smattering of elemental strategy.
Strategy? Strategy, latitude, latitude.
I have it. You'll say a better major general and never satisfy.
You'll say a better major general and never satisfy. You'll say a better major general and never satisfy. You'll say a better major general and never satisfy.
For my
military knowledge, though I am plucky and adventurous, has only been but down to the beginning of the century, but still in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general. And now that I have introduced myself, I should like to have some idea of what's going on.
Oh, Papa.
Permit me. I'll explain in two words. We propose to marry your daughters.
Dear me.
Against our wills, Papa. Against our wills.
Oh, but you mustn't do that. May I ask? This is a picturesque uniform, but I'm not familiar with it. What are you?
We are all single gentlemen.
Yes, I gathered that. Anything else?
No. Nothing else.
Papa, don't believe them. They are pirates. The famous pirates of Penzance.
The pirates of Penzance? I have often heard of them.
All except this gentleman, who was a pirate once, but who is out of his indentures today, and who means to lead a blameless life evermore.
But wait a bit. I object to pirates as sons-in-law.
We object to major generals as fathers-in-law. But we waive that point. We do not press it. We look over it.
Ah, an idea. And do you mean to say that you would deliberately rob me of these, the sole remaining props of my old age, and leave me to go through the remainder of my life unfriended, unprotected, and alone?
Well, yes, that's the idea.
Tell me. Have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Oh, that's it all! Here we are again.
I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Orphan?
Yes, orphan. Have you ever known what it is to be one?
I say orphan.
Orphan! Orphan! Orphan!
I don't think we quite understand one another. When you said orphan, did you mean orphan a person who has lost his parents? Or often, frequently.
I beg pardon, I see what you mean. Frequently.
You said often frequently.
No, only once.
Exactly. You said often frequently only once. Oh, men of dark and dismal fate, forgo your cruel employ. Have pity on my lonely state. I am an orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
An orphan boy. Children whom you see are all that I can call my own.
Poor fellow.
Take them away from me and I shall be indeed alone.
Poor fellow.
If pity you can feel, leave me my sole remaining joy. See at your feet they kneel, your hearts you cannot steal, against the sad, sad tale of a lonely orphan boy.
Poor fellow, see at our feet they kneel, our hearts we cannot steal, against the sad, sad.
Boy,
poor fellow.
And
telling a terrible story, but it doesn't diminish my glory, for they would have taken my daughters over the billowy waters. If I hadn't an elegant diction, indulged in an innocent fiction, which is not in the same category as telling a regular terrible story.
Awesome.